seal, vote, and deliver Trump's presidential victory today. So then it'll be over, right? Nope. In the first week of January, you'll have in Congress where they'll read it through and tabulate it all, and then it's over. Wrong. Then we have the inauguration, and then it will be final. We'll have our next president.
But then the next campaign starts.
Yes. I think it started yesterday. Right. All right. So the president-elect is doing his thank you tour. He says it's helping boost the spirits of America. Is that true? He did start making a point, somewhat of an early Christmas gift for the president-elect from Michelle Obama for this recent statement.
Now we're feeling what not having hope feels like, you know.
Michelle Obama said yesterday that there's no hope. But I assume she was talking about the past, not the future.
Let's bring back our panel, Errol Lewis, Maggie Haberman, and Philip Mudd. Errol, you know, when this came out last week, I said, oh, boy, she just gave them a gift, because this was kind of the second time, right, in the beginning of the administration, Michelle Obama said, I'm finally proud of my country.
Right,
now
right,
here at the end, she says this. What kind of fodder is this for Trump? How does he use it? What does it mean?
Well, I mean, it depends on whether he means what he says about let's bring the country back together again. These tours, which have been, you know, solely for his supporters and throwing them red meat, attacking the press, ridiculing his opponents and so forth, is not necessarily the way you try and bring things back together again. Michelle Obama has sort of played right into that and sort of saying it's still a divided nation, but I won. And that's really kind of what this thank you tour is about, saying it's divided, but we won. It's kind of a morale boost, I think, for him, for his supporters, trying to shore up some of these poll numbers that are floating out there. The reality is they've got to be a little bit concerned that they come into power with their approval ratings very, very low historically. And in some cases, you know, sort of upside down, disapproval ratings exceeding the approval ratings. Makes it very hard to get started on a high note. So I think if he wants to continue to play backlash politics, you know, sort of divisive politics, that will work for him, I suppose, in any given arena. It won't change the numbers. It's not going to help him get his first budget passed. It's going to cause, in some ways, more problems than it might be worth.
I mean, wasn't that also just Exhibit A, what Michelle Obama said, of the polarization in this country? She thinks that now the country doesn't have hope, whereas half the country that voted for him feels extremely hopeful and excited that things are about to turn around in their direction. Part of where they get that is from Donald Trump's rallies. Donald Trump admitted this weekend that somebody in his staff is telling him to back off on the rallies, but he doesn't want to. So here is Mr. Trump.
This is the last time I'll be speaking at a rally for maybe a while, you know? They're saying, as president, he shouldn't be doing rallies, but I think we should, right?
Yeah.
We've done everything else the opposite. Well, no, this is the way you get an honest word out, because you can't give it to them because they're so dishonest.
Oh, that was a twofer. I didn't realize there was.
Except, you know, just to the extent that he wants to apply truth to this, because this is politics, right? He's
sure.
Politics. He didn't get half the vote. Okay, he got about 46% of the vote, and only half of the country voted. So
yeah,
you wind up getting half of a half.
Yes.
So he's got a long way to go,
sure,
to expand his tent. He can have rallies all he likes.
I hear you. I guess my point is the enthusiasm is on one side of the country. She can't say that people are hopeless across the country.
I mean, I think that his supporters feel hopeful and his detractors don't, which is not uncommon in an election, but I don't remember an election that was as visceral and nasty as this one. So it is a little different. Number one. Number two, I think Errol is right. I think that, look, he's not coming in with a historic high in terms of approval ratings. Some of this is that we have seen a change across the country in terms of how people come into office. They come in with higher unfavorables just because the tenor has gotten nastier. There's an enormous distrust among voters across the board of elected officials and of politicians. But that means he has no real cushion if something goes wrong. So the first time that there was some kind of a controversy, he doesn't have an enormous well of good feeling to rely on, and it will give a lot of fodder to his opponents. That is something he has to be careful with. He said two things that were very, very specific to him there. One was about, you know, I have to speak to you directly because this is the only way to get a word out. This is an idea that consumes his team, is the idea that we need to get around what they would call a filter. Others would call it fact-checking and making clear, you know, sort of when he says something that isn't true. But he also is continuing continuing to use we about his own supporters. It's really right. interesting. This is something that he started doing very early on in his rallies in 2015. It was very we versus them.
Right.
He's still doing that as president. That's difficult.
It worked then. But now he wants the consensus. I'm sure that being approved of is at the top of his yep. list. He can't do it with the numbers that he has right now. Phil Mudd, something else he's doing that we hear from people in your community is by attacking the institutions of the democracy, you guys on the intelligence side, the government, the media, that he is creating opportunity for enemies abroad. Why could that be true?
I think if you look at people like me who work in the CIA and the FBI, both of organizations have been attacked by Mr. Trump. You go into this thinking not what happened, but how do I serve the president moving forward? How do I walk into the Oval Office assuming he wants to see people from the Bureau and from the agency? How do I present a nonpartisan view on what's happening in terms of Iranian cooperation or lack of cooperation on the nuclear on Chinese activities in the South China Sea? I think the question for someone who has to go in, not only as president, but to manage the executive branch, is when people walk into the Oval Office, are they going to be honest with me? Are they going to look at how I attacked him and say, I'm not going to give this guy the truth because he doesn't want to hear it?
Mm. Errol, very quickly, Attorney General Loretta Lynch sat down with Jake Tapper this weekend, and for the first time, we heard her express real regret for what happened on the tarmac with Bill Clinton. Listen to this.
I do regret sitting down and having a conversation with him because it did give people concern. And my greatest concern has always been making sure that people understand that the Department of Justice works in a way that's independent and looks at everybody equally. And when you do something that gives people a reason to think differently, that's a problem. It was a problem for me. It was painful for me. And so I felt it was important to clarify it as quickly and as clearly and as cleanly as possible.
I wonder if when it was happening, she knew what the ramifications would be.
You know, I've known her for a while. She, in fact, you know, lived in my neighborhood in Brooklyn. She's not a politician. You know, I mean, I took her at her word at the time, and I think this even underscores it, is that she was blindsided by that. You know, I mean, whatever he had in mind, Bill Clinton had in mind, playing this three-dimensional chess, which is the way his political mind operates, she was in some ways almost like a dupe in that. She's not somebody who's thinking four and five steps ahead and what the impression is going to be and how it's going to affect the election and what it's going to do to her legacy and her reputation and so forth. I think she basically got corralled into a political move, and I think that was her expression of regret that she allowed that to happen. Mm-hmm.